started over there. I could hear the noise of the planes and then the explosions. There were blasts of hot air. I tried to pray.
We were up against the tree, so we couldn't see. And we kept hearing the bullets whistling past.
It was all bright, lit up like a full moon. Everything was burning. It gave off a tremendous light.
I think Steer's report of the bombing of Gernika, which appeared on the 28th of April, on the Wednesday, on the front page of the New York Times, and as the turnover article in the Times, had a greater impact than any other story in the Spanish Civil War.
I was born here in Guernica in 1922. Guernica was a small town with a population of around 5,000 people. To a great extent, it lived off the countryside. There were lots of farmhouses around here. They came in on Mondays to sell their produce here, and the shops lived off that.
Guernica then was half the size it is now. The town has grown a lot. But in those days, it was a place where everyone knew each other. It was a very homely town.
We went to school every day, and we helped our mother in the market. We'd lead the donkey, and she'd distribute the milk. And then we'd go to school. That was until we were nine. Then came the bombing.
Gernika was a small medieval town, dating back to the 14th century. At that time, it had a population of under 5,000. It was a place of exchange for all the surrounding rural area. There was also a fledgling industry, partly linked to arms manufacture. There were good rail connections to the capital, Bilbao. So that was more or less the context in 1936, or at least before the war.
Someone went to my mother and said, Gerundina, that was her name, the war's broken out. What are we going to do, Marcelino? Gather up your things, because things are going to get very bad around here.
Basically, what happened on the 18th of July, 1936, was a coup d'etat. It was a failed coup d'etat which led to a great schism in Spanish society. There was the army, which had the political backing of the Catholic right, the traditional right wing, which supported the rising. And then there were the forces of the Popular Front, the democratic forces, the forces of the left, who defended the rule of law and the republic.
Already in the start of the 1930s, we were starting to see this terrifying polarization in Europe, which destroyed the center ground. You saw in Germany the rise of Hitler in 1933 coming to power, with Mussolini already in Italy. They were soon to form the axis between themselves. On the other side, obviously, the Soviet Union. But the democracies of, say, Britain and France were left in a very complicated position, particularly France, which in itself had a potential revolution or a potential civil war within its own borders.
At heart, Hitler really had no strategic interest in Western Europe. But in the mid-1930s, he realized that despite his initial expectations, Britain would not remain neutral if he went to war in the East. Entering into a pact with Mussolini on the Spanish scenario was actually a way of strengthening the bonds between the two allies.
The 18th of July, I had a girlfriend in Irlandia, and I was planning to meet up with her and go for a walk, just like we always did. Then someone said, they've rebelled in Africa. Who's rebelled? Who do you think, for God's sake? The army. And I said, so what do we do? We have to go and get some shotguns and a blanket. Fine, but I have no shotgun. So he says, we have to requisition all the shotguns and revolvers and go out and patrol.
Franco sent emissaries straight to Hitler to ask for transport aircraft, which he needed to send the Army of Africa across the Straits of Gibraltar to southern Spain. On the 25th of July, Franco's two emissaries arrived in Berlin on a Lufthansa plane, and they were transferred down to southern Germany, where Hitler was at the Wagner Festival of Bayreuth. And after the opera had finished, Hitler was enthused, decided to help them immediately, and ordered the dispatch of Junkers 52 transport aircraft, which were also used as bombers. And Goering was so carried away by this wonderful opportunity for his Luftwaffe to prove itself that he even came out with a code word, Feuerzauber, which means magic fire, which was the name of the last act from the opera.
This was the first plane sent from Germany to Spain, and this is the version they sent. It was a troop carrier. It played an important part in the air bridge across the Straits of Gibraltar. With these planes, they could fly around 500 men across a day, practically an entire battalion every day. They built six vertical shafts into the fuselage, and each one could hold a 250-kilo bomb. Or they could replace the 250-kilo bomb with 450-kilo bombs. And they could also take packets of 12 incendiary bombs, weighing 1 kilogram each.
The Italian intervention in Spain commenced on the 31st of July 1936. The decision was taken after they learned that the French government was sending guns and planes to the Spanish Republic. The first expedition consisted of 12 planes, which flew from Sardinia to Nador in Spanish Morocco.
When the Spanish Civil War broke out, military aviation was in the midst of a transformation. The Spanish aircraft were all obsolete, but so were the French planes and half of the English ones. Not the Germans, though, because they hadn't had an air force before 1933. That was one of the stipulations of the Treaty of Versailles, which the Germans completely flouted. But that began to change with the arrival of the first Italian Fiat fighters. During that initial stage, they were the best. That changed the whole course of the war. It allowed the rebel columns to advance from the south, from Seville to Toledo, and right up to Makeda without any problem. But then came the Soviet Expeditionary Air Corps, which was the first modern type aviation to reach Spain.
The Germans needed the Italians. In particular, they needed the Italian fighters to escort their bombers, which were very slow and vulnerable. Their Henkel fighters were no match whatsoever for the Russian fighters.
The first stage, really, of the Spanish Civil War was the rapid advance of the Army of Africa, of legionnaires and Moroccan troops, up through Andalusia from the south all the way up towards Madrid.
George Steer was sent by the Times as a correspondent to report on the Spanish Civil War from the frontier. So his first involvement with the Spanish Civil War was seeing the war in the northern Basque Country. Then Steer left the employment of the Times in order to finish his book on Abyssinia, and he went into nationalist-held territory. He finished his book there in Burgos. He ended up in Toledo. All this was Franco-held territory, and he found it pretty unpleasant.
This is when the French approached the British and proposed the non-intervention committee. To a certain degree, the British may even have suggested it themselves. But be that as it may, the end result was an agreement that perhaps for the Republic's sake, it would be better to have a complete cordon sanitaire around Spain, preventing weapons getting in from any direction.
George Steer's ironic about it. If you look at the back of the jacket of his book, The Tree of Gernika, describes it as the first description of the effect of non-intervention in Spain. And you plainly see that non-intervention means that the fascists win.
Franco insisted on having one offensive after another all the way around Madrid. And it was only in the spring of 1937 when he was persuaded by his German advisors that the place to attack was the north, because otherwise he would just simply fail again.
Und jetzt brauchte man einen schnellen Gegenerfolg.
The rebels urgently needed a success. And there was that narrow strip in the north, along the Atlantic coast of Biscay. It was at that point that the Condor Legion became a compact, autonomous air force, as it continued to be for the rest of the Spanish Civil War.
The Republican zone in the north was not at all cohesive. In the center, you had the Asturias and Santander, the main leadership, if you like, was socialist and communist. The Basque Country, on the other hand, was very, very different. The Basques were much more conservative and Catholic. Their leadership was much more Christian Democrat, if you like. The only reason why they had sided really with the Republic was because the Republic had promised them autonomy.
There were Basque Catholics who supported Franco's side and Basque Catholics who supported the Republic. The Catholic nationalists did position themselves on the side of the Republic because it defended Basque autonomy, but it was unusual in this regard. It was the only denominational Catholic party that sided with the Republic. To a certain extent, that is why it was so strategically important among the panoply of forces supporting the Republican rule of law.
Steer's experience in nationalist Spain was very unhappy. It was a hideous place, frightful people. But when he came to the Basque Country in January 1937, the Basque government welcomed him and said, you can see what you want. They wanted to help him, so he had good contacts. This helps a journalist to have this kind of access.
The front was only about 30 or 40 kilometers from Gernika. The town wasn't actually on the front, but it was relatively close.
There were troops billeted all over the town, in the Santa Clara convent and the Mercedarian convent, and in the Augustinian monastery. There were barracks in all the large buildings.
Sometimes we were sent out to the front line. When we were on reserve, they used to call us the plug. We'd wait to see where they tried to break through the lines and go in and counterattack. So we were right here in Gernika.
And of course, there were more and more people in Gernika. We just went about our daily business. I was 13 when the war broke out.
The campaign in the Basque country began with an air force of 73 Italian planes, somewhat over 80 German planes, and about 16 Spanish ones. The Spanish planes did the reconnaissance work. The Germans provided most of the heavy bombers with their junkers, and the Italians supplied the fighters.
The offensive was immediately backed up with air raids deep behind the front, targeting the reserves and the divisional commands, and incidentally, according to Richthofen, without taking into account the civilian population.
The main commander of the Condor Legion was General Hugo Speller, and he, in fact, was based with Franco at his general headquarters. The key character, really, was the field commander, Colonel Wolfram von Richthofen, and he was a brutal, hard man who was even loathed by fellow officers in Germany, in the Luftwaffe, and above all in the army.
Richthofen, at the time, was head of the Joint High Command of the three air forces assigned to the north. So Richthofen wasn't just in charge of the Condor Legion, he was also head of the Joint High Command.
Richthofen noted down his personal impressions on all their activities and wrote them out every night in a journal. These manuscripts were then sent to Berlin, but they weren't kept in the Luftwaffe's archives or the Condor Legion's archive. So these documents are very authoritative.
Steer was living in this hotel with the other journalists, so he was living in a city under bombardment and then going off to the front. The Basque country is not that big, and you could get pretty well anywhere. And the fighting was getting closer and closer to the city.
Because the Germans could communicate directly with their main agents in the Spanish units, they often had a better overall understanding of the military situation than the Spanish staff themselves. As a result, according to von Richthofen, their influence over operations as a whole was decisive.
So from a military point of view, von Richthofen clearly saw what had to be done. Moller had given an order to occupy first Durango and then Guernica. But in view of the situation, von Richthofen felt that it would be better to do it in reverse order. At the time, von Richthofen was doing his best to convince Vigon, who was Solchaga's chief of staff. But Moller remained unswayed about the idea of taking Durango first and then Guernica.
The morning of the bombing was normal until noon. And then about 12 o'clock or 1, lots of planes started flying over.
The Condor Legion made two raids on the 26th of April. In the morning, they bombed the crossroads at Gericaith. And then in the afternoon, they cut off the same road further up and the coast road, where the two roads met, a few meters before the Renteria Bridge, also called the Guernica Bridge.
Monday, the 26th of April, 1937, seemed like another ordinary day of the war. The journalists would go to the Carlton Hotel, they would get a car and a driver, and they would go away. And he drove east of, or was driven east of Guernica to a place called Arzanegi Gericais, which has got two villages, a crossroad, and it had just been bombed when over the ridge came half a dozen Heinkel 51 fighters. They were equipped with machine guns and they came down and they were shooting at them. So he dived into the lay there with these bloody little planes, as he called them, machine gunned.
We thought they wanted to divide the front in two, split it in Amorebieta, so that they could catch all the Republican forces in that sector. We never thought they'd bomb a defenseless town with no military targets.
Von Richthofen had a military reason for attacking Gernika. He wanted to cut off the battlefield. It was a tactical decision. The whole Basque front had collapsed on the 25th of April. And he saw an opportunity to surround a large proportion of the Basque forces who were in the area around Markina.
A plane. Whenever a plane flew over, they used to run up a flag here and they'd ring the bell at Santa Maria.
Sometimes the sirens went off, and that's when we were really scared. What's happening? There are planes coming. Where do we go?
My father always said, if they ring the bells, go to the shelter up there. And he was on the alert, and he took us there when they started ringing the bells.
There was a man there that day who said, why are they ringing the bells? I told him, it's an alert, it means there are planes. He was frightened and asked me where there was a shelter. At first, there were makeshift shelters all over the place. They put some sacks of earth up here, and this place here, which is just two stories high, was a shelter. But once they saw what happened when they bombed other places like Eibar and Durango, they dug four tunnels here. And there were other shelters around the town.
One was next to the town hall, at the bottom of town. There was one enclosed one there, but these ones in the street, well, they say about 70 people died there.
They told us that if there was an air raid, we shouldn't go to the shelters. We should always try to run out across the fields.
But anyway, we went up there. The bank was just across there. We went up there, crossed this, and reached that part there. This was where the market was. It was full. There were people from the villages selling things, orange growers, the ironmongers, all that.
The first to reach Gernika was a reconnaissance plane, the Dornier 17, a twin-engine monoplane with retractable landing gear and a double tail fin. Very distinctive. So this plane flew from Burgos to Vitoria. Once it had crossed the front, it flew on up, but then came in from Mount Oith, more or less, and went straight to Gernika and bombed the bridge. He bombed it from east to west, along the bridge in two runs.
When we got here to the square, we heard the first explosions, a fair bit away. Everyone in the market ran to the shelters. Someone pushed me into the first one, which was here. Everyone squeezed in, and they were all pressed in together.
Look, a plane, because of the noise. And it turned round. That one was on its own, but suddenly three more appeared. And they began to fly past.
Then when the first bomb fell, we said, where did it fall? Over in San Juan Ibarra. Let's see what's happened, whether there's anyone wounded. But in that meantime, the three planes came.
And they said, it looks like it hit the Rentería area. Let's see what happened. We'd just gone a few meters when the bell started ringing again. And that second time, I didn't go back to the shelter.
They just started using the Savoia 79s in Spain. They'd seen very little service on the Aragon front, but this was the first time they came north. They flew them here from Soria. All the Italian bombers were in Soria.
It's important to remember that the Italians intervened in answer to a request from the Spanish command. The base at Soria was alerted, and because they had the planes ready for action, they went into action ahead of the Condor Legion. The order was number 48. Here it is. It clearly says, objective, bomb the bridge at Gernika. The enemy is withdrawing towards Bilbao through Gernika, where various roads from the east converge, meeting at the Gernika bridge to the east of the town. The town, for obvious political reasons, must not be bombed. So the three S-79s flew out with a payload of 36 50-kilo bombs, which was considered sufficient to destroy the small bridge across the Oka River on the outskirts of Gernika.
And they came from Soria. They naturally took a south-north route and reached the sea quite far to the right of Gernika. Then they turned around at El Anchove and came back up the Mundaka estuary and bombed the bridge from north to south.
The bombing started over there. I could hear the noise of the planes and the explosions. There were blasts of hot air. I tried to pray. In Sunday school, they told us that if we were ever in mortal danger, we should say a prayer.
And that was when we came here, where we took shelter, and where we stayed right through the whole bombing here in Chorroborough. We saw the whole thing from here, everything.
The lead aeroplane was the one that gave all the instructions, all the orders. The navigator lined Captain Castellani's plane up on a certain line and began preparing the launch sequence, dropping the bombs at regular intervals, and the other two planes in the patrol followed suit. Captain Castellani's report, when he got back, shows that they arrived over the target at 16:30 and dropped their bombs from 3,600 meters. The report says the drop was wide and, among other things, hit the railway station. We also have an aerial photograph which shows that some bombs fell before the bridge. The other ones missed the target and hit the railway station, parallel to the road.
Some of them up there. Where are we going to hide? Where do we go now? So we said, down here.
Of course, there was no light in there. We were all curled up, all still. Maybe someone lit a candle or something, but there was no light, nothing. When I see it now, it really gets to me. This isn't the same bunker I saw then. I was just a child and it looked huge. So it was people from the district who were in there. There can't have been more than 100 of us in there.
Another different patrol was also sent to escort the junkers. The only report we have of the action is the account by Lieutenant Corrado Ricci, who said he and his patrol had taken off twice and that one of them didn't find the German planes where they were supposed to rendezvous.
Lieutenant Ricci had a patrol of five Fiats and was patrolling the area around his aerodrome in Vittoria, waiting for the main German formation. But they were half an hour late, which really surprised Ricci, because he said that the Germans from the Condor Legion were extraordinarily punctual. After they'd been there an hour and a half, a Heinkel 111 appeared, and they escorted it to Gernika.
The planes flew over us. Then they dropped and turned. There was a poor woman who was just climbing the hill. And as the plane flew past, she began hurling insults at the pilot. And she really lashed out at him. The plane dived straight down. And I could see the pilot's goggles. And da-da-da-da-da, he killed the woman.
And then, because Luigi had been half an hour flying around Vitoria, after flying to Guernica and back, he'd run out of fuel. So he had to land. But he said that before he landed, he saw a formation coming. He said they were 17 Junker 52s. That's still not quite clear whether there were 17, 18, or 19. But that's a fairly small margin of doubt.
Based on their previous combat experience, the Condor Legion was proud of being able to hit, from a height of 2,000 meters, targets that were only 300 meters from their own lines. So nobody in the Condor Legion could have expected that if the target was the Gernika Bridge, Renteria, and the roads, that none of the bombs would fall in the center of the town.
The fact is that when the Junkers got there, they knew their flight path perfectly well. They too went as far as the sea, flying parallel to the front. And then they came in up the Mundaka estuary from north to south.
The aeroplanes came from over there, where Mount Oith is, where those aerials are on Mount Oith. They came from there, towards here, then they came in towards the estuary. They turned round over there, came up the estuary, and then they started bombing.
The first squadron did do all the approach maneuvers and calculated the wind drift and all that. But the second squadron couldn't, because the whole area was obscured by smoke from the explosions. So all they could do was drop the bombs into the smoke. And the third squadron, and von Kraft told me this in full detail, did the same. The only thing they could see was the smoke and some flames, so they bombed into it.
And then the bombs dropped. They started falling horizontally, and then they turned vertically and they fell that way.
They echoed in here. Boom, boom, boom. The whole time. It came wave after wave. It would stop for a while, and it seemed like it had finished. But then again, it started up.
So when I came out, I was horrified. The whole town was on fire. I panicked.
I remember when we got out, my mother, my late mother, said, "Don't step on those people on the ground because they're asleep." Of course, later I realized they weren't asleep. They were dead.
And then as we went down to Guernica, when we were getting to the entrance to the town, we saw 7 or 8 people with their heads blown open, lying dead. There were people from Guernica, including a boy called Cipri Arien, who was the same age as me.
I ran into another friend of mine, and we went up the side of the hill. We sat there and we watched Guernica burning.
The greatest destruction of Guernica came after the bombing. At most, 15% of the buildings were burnt during the bombing itself, but altogether, 70% were burned down. So the large-scale destruction was caused by the fire.
It was all bright, like a full moon. Everything was burning. It gave off a tremendous light.
Suddenly the whole house just collapsed. Like the pictures of the World Trade Center, that house just collapsed the same way. And my friend says, look, my aunt and my grandmother are in there, one deaf and the other paralytic. One hadn't realized what was happening and the other couldn't move.
Father, father, it's me, I said. And he said, yes, darling, there were five of us, and I was the only one to get out alive.
Some of the women were running around, screaming and shouting. But what could we soldiers do? We helped out as best as we could. We gathered up the wounded, the living, and so on. But we couldn't start to dig up the rubble because it was all so terrible, terrible. And there were still those incendiary bombs. Those ones that are like that, full of little holes and go.
They went back to file their stories, ships that came in, attacks that had happened, you know, list of places that had been bombed, lots of places that had been bombed, Markino, Arzanegi, Gericaid. And it's my understanding they were eating late, Spanish style, when news came, either in people or in a phone call, that Gernika was on fire. So the journalists threw down their napkins, called for their cars, and set off. By now it's night, past 10 o'clock. And they drive east, and then as they turn north up towards Gernika, they can see this pink glow in the sky behind the Black Hills at night. And this is a town on fire. And they drove in. Now, the bombers had gone. They had used incendiary bombs, and this caught the place alive.
The bombers that had hit Gericaid in the morning got back to Burgos late. Over lunch, they told them the target for the afternoon was the bridge in Gernika. Specifically, it was von Kraft, the head of the 3rd Squadron, who gave the order. I had a lot of correspondence with him. He said he had loaded up the planes the same as in the morning. 4 of the 6 bomb bays with explosives, and 2 with incendiary devices. And they also had extra boxes of incendiary bombs loaded in the aisles, which they dropped out of the door of the plane. They removed the door before taking off, and they had 2 extra soldiers to push the boxes out. They sat on the floor, pushed them with their feet, and dropped them out of the door, just like that.
Steer picked up the evidence of what had happened in Gernika itself, and these were shiny, silvery incendiary bombs. I mean, the evidence was actually on the incendiary bombs because they had a stamp on them. They had the German eagle with the head and RH and 1936, Rheindorf factory, 1936. The manufacturer's mark was on them. This is the evidence that a journalist needs. And these incendiary bombs, which incidentally are exactly the same kind of incendiary bomb that dropped here in London from the Blitz, these incendiary bombs were sort of tested first in Spain. And the most dramatic example of them is Gernika. Gernika, the most ancient town of the Basques, and center of their cultural tradition, was completely destroyed yesterday afternoon by insurgent air raiders. The bombardment of this open town, far behind the lines, occupied precisely 3 hours and a quarter, during which a powerful fleet of aeroplanes, consisting of 3 German types, Junkers and Heinkel bombers and Heinkel fighters, did not cease unloading on the town bombs weighing from 1,000 pounds downwards and, it is calculated, more than 3,000 two-pounder aluminium incendiary projectiles. The fighters, meanwhile, plunged low from above the center of the town to machine gun those of the civilian population who had taken refuge in the fields. In the form of its execution, and the scale of the destruction it wrought, no less than in the selection of its objective. The raid on Gernika is unparalleled in military history. Gernika was not a military objective. The object of the bombardment was seemingly the demoralization of the civil population and the destruction of the cradle of the Basque race. The tactics of the bombers, which may be of interest to students of the new military science, were as follows. First, small parties of aeroplanes threw heavy bombs and hand grenades all over the town, choosing area after area in orderly fashion. Next came fighting machines, which swooped low to machine gun those who ran in panic from dugouts, some of which had already been penetrated by 1,000-pound bombs, which make a hole 25 feet deep. Many of these people were killed as they ran. A large herd of sheep being brought into the market was also wiped out. The object of this move was apparently to drive the population underground again, for next, as many as 12 bombers had appeared at a time, dropping heavy and incendiary bombs upon the ruins. The rhythm of this bombing of an open town was, therefore, a logical one. First, hand grenades and heavy bombs to stampede the population, then machine gunning to drive them below, next, heavy and incendiary bombs to wreck the houses and burn them on top of their victims.
La prensa judía y masónica del mundo y las hipócritas plañideras de Valencia rasgaron sus vestiduras ante caudillo, cuyo nombre limpio como nuestro cielo pretendieron manchar con la baba de su información calumniosa. La cámara fotográfica que no sabe mentir dice bien claro que tanta y tamaña destrucción no fue sino obra de incendiarios y dinamiteros.
Aujourd'hui, Guernica n'est plus qu'un amas de ruines. Vision tragique qui nous rappelle celle des villages de la Meuse après les combats qui se livrèrent autour de Verdun.
Das sind die Ruinen der altspanischen Stadt Guernica. Wenige Stunden nachdem die bolschewistischen Mordbrenner von den nationalen Truppen vertrieben worden waren. Die jüdische Lügenpresse behauptete, deutsche Flugzeuge hätten die Stadt bombardiert. Jedoch musste die internationale Weltpresse diese Meldung sehr bald als Pressemanöver der Bolschewisten brandmarken, welche selbst die gesamte Stadt beim Verlassen Haus für Haus niedergebrannt hatten.
They said on the radio that when Generalissimo Franco's troops entered the town, they found all of Guernica razed to the ground by the red separatists. But that's not true. And I'm one of those who saw the bombing from start to finish.
In those days, the Times was a paper of record. All members of Parliament read it, everybody important read it. It's in the Times. So the reaction was read by bishops, people like this, and parliamentarians. And so you had this reaction in the church, in Parliament, among the trade unions, the people who supported the Republic. Schools, all sorts of places. There was a terrific public outrage. Now, here was an example. A whole town burned. And not just any town. This was the most special town to the Basques, because that's what Steer talked about. This is attacked and firebombed by German and Italian planes. And look out, boys. It's coming for you.
Entonces esto era...
This was an experiment for the Germans. For the German aviation. Which was preparing for the upcoming war. Because Hitler was already planning and going to war.
Meines Erachtens war dieser Angriff ein Kriegsverbrechen.
It is my belief that this was a war crime. Richthofen targeted not only the bridge and the roads, but also the district of Renteria. So in that sense, ordering the destruction of human life in Renteria was a war crime. It wasn't a planned massacre, but that was the result.
So that means that the bombs that fell around the bridge, the ones that were closest, the ones at the junction immediately in front of it, those were 5 or 10 meters from the bridge. There were 4 hits very close to the bridge. But then the bulk of the bombs fell 100 or 200 meters from the bridge, and the bridge is 15 meters long. So the likelihood of actually hitting that bridge is really, I wouldn't say impossible, but very difficult.
It would have been very difficult to hit the bridge, especially since they were bombing it from 3,600 meters up.
I think what Richthofen wanted to do was to destroy the railway and the road to Amore Vieta and cut off the way through altogether. He more or less said so. Not, of course, in so many words, but that's the idea that comes across in his notes. Between the 27th and the 28th, the gravedigger buried 14 bodies. And then in the Calzada home, about 45 people died. They were all identified. And then the other major focus was in the bomb shelter in Santa Maria.
We'll never know. They were left in the rubble. Because just when they could have done the statistics, Franco's forces arrived. You could already hear the artillery fire up the river.
So according to my list, 126 people were killed. But I calculate that there were probably only 100, because of the 50, half were unidentified. But I later added all the people that the registry office added subsequently, so the figure of 126 presumes that they were different people. I've said on several occasions in different forums that if anyone knows of a relative or acquaintance who's not on the list, they can tell me and I'll add the name, but nobody's ever written or said anything.
And then, when they got here, my father had to go with the oxen, gathering up the bits of corpse to take them to the graveyard. Bit by bit, an arm, a head, another bit. When they got home, they couldn't even eat.
Because there's no pity. In war, there's no pity. Men kill each other without mercy.
The key thing with Gernika was that you had foreign journalists reporting, an international row. You then had the nationalists making these preposterous lies, trying to claim that it wasn't them. And this, in fact, focused the whole of the propaganda war surrounding the Civil War, which was, let's face it, to a large degree, a world war by proxy, and representing this sort of split in the whole of Europe, even the whole world at this particular stage. And so it was hardly surprising that the Guernica would suddenly become such a powerful symbol. And that was even before Picasso had, had picked up his paintbrush.
It was a good lesson, which was later taken very seriously, and it still is. War brings nothing but grief and bloodshed. That's why we haven't had a war for so long now.
You might say that the victory of the Condor Legion set the stage for the offset of the Second World War. They thought, we're invincible in the air. The pilots not only became heroes, they were almost like today's film stars, signing autographs and the like.
We always said, my God, the people down there are far worse off than us.
A lot more of them die than us up here. We're much better off. We see it all from a long way off. We don't see the real misery.
I think the bombing could be said to be the first in history to have been carried out on a town to provoke a reaction by the population against the war.
When they got back to Germany, they were received with great military honors in Hamburg and Berlin. Goebbels' propaganda machinery got working in May and June 1939. It was a card that the Nazi propaganda played very effectively in the Second World War.
Then we said, this is a warning. The French should take note, British should take note. What is happening to us won't stop there.
Das, was in Gernika passiert ist, war ein Massaker, es war ein Kriegsverbrechen.
What happened in Gernika was a massacre, a war crime. I think that's why Gernika, together with other cities, is still a potent symbol. Because it reminds us that the military side to technological advance has terrible consequences. Remembering those cities leads us to reflect on ways of containing war, especially air raids. How to make further progress on the Hague agreements, which hasn't happened to date. And Gernika serves to publicly emphasize that need.
Auf diese Notwendigkeit hinzuweisen.
It was Juan Gutiérrez who got the German president to recognize that it had been the German Condor Legion that bombed Gernika.
I want to assume that past and expressly recognize the blame of the German aircraft involved. To you, the survivors of the attack and witnesses of the horror, I send my commemorative and heartfelt message of condolence and grief. I evoke the memory of those people.
And so I answered him on behalf of the survivors. 60 years ago, we had an unexpected visit in Gernika. Many of us were still children. Some men came from other lands who didn't know us and whom we didn't know, but who didn't see us as we were, because they were up above and we were down below. If they had all been down at our level, they would have seen that we were children, just like the children in their country. Maybe from up there we looked like ants desperately running away, and we couldn't talk to each other. Men and ants can't talk to each other, and they dropped a rain of fire, shrapnel, and death down on us. And they destroyed our town. That night, we could no longer go back and have dinner at home or sleep in our beds. We had no hope. But that incomprehensible act didn't leave us with a feeling of hatred or revenge, but an enormous desire for peace, a conviction that such a thing should never happen again, and that from the ruins of what our town had been, a flag of peace should rise up for all the peoples of the world. Excuse me. Sorry, I get a bit affected by this.